Let's go into the mathematics. Neuro-mathematics. I told you about the steps that we take, and I will begin with the very first layers of filters, the simple filters right here. How could they come up? Because if you are born, you're a baby, you create these filters yourself. And you create them not by design, but you create them by learning. And that means you have some self-organization principle. And what is the principle of self-organization in babies? How does the... It turns out that all these networks, when you are born, they are not configured yet. You are born as the same as a neural network. It's a random network. There are no connections yet formed. You have to look. And by looking, you learn. So I'm going to give you some examples. What are the principles of self-organization of these filters? And then first layer, second layer, etc. So we saw these networks, and all these networks are convolutions. I'm going to show you that convolution is actually a measure of template matching. If you want to find something in an image, for example, you have a text with letters, you want to find the letter A, or you take a small filter with the letter A, and you scan it over your page, and every time your filter is on an A, you have an exact match, which means the correlation is 1. And if it's not on an A, the correlation is 0.6 or 0.5, and it's not as good. So if you scan with a particular pattern, you find it. Well, if the pattern is left is minus 1 and this is plus 1, you measure the difference, that's an S detector. You just scan it and you match every time, you match that pattern. And that pattern is an edge. You can match it with a cat, you can match it with a letter. It's called template matching. So we go forward and backward. We have this back-propagation. And this is template matching. I'm going to show you some mathematical examples. Suppose you have this text, and I want to find the A and the E. So let's... Okay, given time, I'll leave it out for now.
That's stupid.
Anyway, you can match this. I'll find it in the next break, and then we. But you believe that the template matching works?
If it sums up to zero, if it's not, the Gaussian, for example, could be more like a blurring. So, would you consider blurring the template matching?
No, that's actually mixing up all your pixels with the Gaussian kernel. Let's look for template matching. Use template matching. Okay, sorry, it takes forever to... Run the whole program. I read an image, and this is my image. And I now make a template. And my template is this. So I have a very tiny pixeled image, that's the A. And now you go look for the A and the E. So I have a very tiny image here and a tiny image there. If you do the convolution, you get something like this, that it peaks everywhere, you have all kinds of high peaks, and the places where you have the high peaks, that is where the E from the template and the E in your image fits together. So you get really nice fitting peaks. And all you have to do is, of course, you can look at this image and you can see from different sides, and you see, okay, the high peaks is exactly what I need to pick out, and that is what the program does. And in the end, what do you get? You perfectly get the A's and the E's detected, because that is where the high peaks were. So template matching is the basic thing. That is actually what the whole convolution is. So if you want to find something, make your filter like this and you find it. Okay. So if you then look at these networks, they do incredibly many of these convolution steps. First, there's very simple detectors, S detectors, and then nose detectors, and phase detectors, etc. So if you study what these filters are learning, and these are the first filters by Krzyzewski, that was the guy who was winning this 1.2 million images detectors with these tough classes, he found those filters. And you see, it's not only edge detection, but it is more complex. And if you look at the details of these filters, you see that they have a structure that they are looking at different orientations. They have different frequencies, black and white. And people have studied in V1 here what are the kernels that these filters in V1 are seeing. So if you stick a needle in one of these cells in V1, your primary visual cortex, and you move a little light over your retina, when is the cell firing? You see that the cell is actually doing exactly the same as the filters we see in deep learning. So in our brain, we find the same filters. And that's quite intriguing. That's quite nice. So maybe this is very similar. So can we understand those filters? And I'd like to give you a little bit of an approach, a little bit mathematical, but it is the approach of first principles. So let's have a look at a single pixel. And I have the pixels here. And these are the pixels of my own face. And these are actually square pixels. And this is the most stupid pixel you can think of. We normally make pixels like this, we zoom in. But there are many things wrong. Because I have no squares in my face. I have no corners in my face. So these are made as an artifact of this zooming in. Because the pixel is wrong. The pixel should not be a square, the pixel should be, of course, a circle, because I don't want corners. The pixel should not have steep edges, but the pixel should be smooth. Maybe the pixel should look like a Gaussian bell. So, what is the best shape of a pixel? So, we're going to look at the optimal aperture from first principles. And if you now do this from first principles, you should say, okay, I have this unknown filter. And this is my pixel. My pixel is called G. And I do this for a one-dimensional filter. So I normally take this a kind of a square box. That's wrong. It should be much more smooth. But I know that this filter should be a normalized filter. So the filter should not, if I integrate the filter, I take the area under the filter. It should be 1, because I do not want the filter to multiply my image by 2 or by 1/2. It should leave the image intact. The mean of the filter, that is how much is it actually measuring all over the place, what is the light coming in, that could be any value, that's x0. And in mathematical terms, that's x times gx. But because I can take any value, I put it to zero. And how wide should be my filter? That could be very narrow, it could be very wide. That is actually given by this formula, x squared, the variance, and I call that sigma squared. And now I want this filter to be as smooth as possible. So I want not any jerk. I do not want edges and corners and all the other stuff. So I want it to have it really smooth. I want no chaos, no disorder. And the physics for chaos is entropy. So I'm going to minimize the entropy. And the entropy is G ln G. That's the mathematics for entropy. So how can I find the minimum of the entropy? Well, it's a mathematical technique, and you just believe that it exists. It is called Euler Lagrange. And I make a formula here where it says, okay, I have here my entropy, and I put all these three constraints, lambda 1 the first, lambda 2 the second, lambda 3 the third. I have a formula here. I go find the minimum. And if I put this in Mathematica, I calculate when is this guy 1, when is this guy 0, when is this guy 3. I get three equations. There are three unknowns, lambda 1, lambda 2, and lambda 3. So I can say Mathematica solve these three equations. It does that. It can do all the beautiful mathematics of this. And what do I find? I find a unique solution. Only one filter fits all this. It's the Gaussian kernel. And that is the best filter. It has no junk.
So when the height of the filter is 0? Oh, the center, yes. Yes.
Yeah, that could be anything. It is just a name there. So I have the Gaussian kernel that is proven to be a unique solution. It's quite nice. And there are 11 of these derivations. It's a very nice field. You can do this from causality, from other ways. Mm-hmm. But entropy is nice. And we have now actually the best filters. And our retina, of course, has those filters. Our retina doesn't have these square blocks. Mm-hmm. These are quite stupid filters. For example, if you see this image of me, if you blur this a little bit, you look through your eyelashes, you make all your pixels Gaussian, and then you see the right image. So that's a unique solution. And now you say, okay, I do a convolution with my Gaussian, and this star means convolution. And the convolution with a Gaussian, with a pixel, is actually an observation. It means I sample, I look at it, I take that measurement. So this, if I take a measurement, this is actually, I blur a little bit, and that's, yeah, my pixels are always finite, I cannot see your molecules because my pixel is too big. I blur the world, of course you have molecules, but yeah, with a big pixel, I blur the world, and here you see that I blur the world a little bit. But now I want to want edges, so I take the derivative of my observation, and this is linear, so I can also put the derivative inside. So I do the convolution with the derivative of a Gaussian. And that guy looks like this. This is the derivative of x, the derivative to y. This is the second derivative of x, x to y, second to y. So this is all the derivatives of a Gaussian. And these derivatives of a Gaussian, they make sense. They look like a Gabor. A Gabor is an approximation, yes. But this is the real nice thing. It's the proper pixel. It really takes derivatives. And why would he take derivatives? Because then we can do high order differential geometry. And we can find corners, we can find T-junctures, the whole thing. And I have a nice lectures about all this. And our visual system takes at least up to the fourth order.
And Laplacians could be approximated simply with the difference of Gaussians?
Well, of course, that's nothing that's the second order trace.
Yes.
They have an invariant structure. And here we have these set of surround structures. But I want to go a little bit further. Why do we have this set of surround structures, this very crazy surrounding here? Well, in deep learning, we have found something special. These receptive fields, as you see, with the center positive and the negative around it, we have them not only in our vision, but we have them everywhere. We have them in our ear, we have them in our skin, we have them in our olfactory system. So everywhere we measure, you have this. And why should that be? Well, there was a nice paper in deep learning. It's called batch normalization. And batch normalization means if you look at data, you should look at how much is the data that I look at different given my surrounding. So I subtract my surrounding. And people did this, they subtracted the surrounding, and they found that they could do this, the training with 14 times fewer training steps, and in the image net they were 4.9 good, they exceed the accuracy of human raters. This was working like crazy, it was just super. You have to do batch normalization. And this set of surrounds, it has nothing to do with locations and so on, it is batch normalization. So that's a whole new field, and everybody is copying what the center surround is doing. That was from the 30s, and people have never studied this critically. It was copied and copied and copied, and it's still in all the lecture books. But I'm now saying it is something much more deep we have not been learning. And now we can tell these biologists, hey, there are new findings, and have a look at this. So if you want to find coordinate systems, you need X and Y. And of course we have very nice x and y in our mathematics, but our vision has no x and y. What is the x-axis in your vision? You don't know. If I change my head, everything is changed. So I have no x and y-axis. If I stand upside down, it's the whole world is changed. So it's ridiculous to talk about x and y. I only have the data. So if I have the data, all these measurements, I can say, hey, maybe there are coordinates in my data. So if I have a cloud of data like this, you could actually say, okay, let's go to principal component analysis. And if I take the longest axis, that's a very natural axis. I can call it X, but I can call it any name, doesn't matter. It's my first axis. It's the most variation is in this direction. And the second variation is in this direction. That's my second natural axis. If I have 3D, you can make as many as you want. And they're all 90 degrees apart, they form a very nice coordinate system. So the data makes my coordinate system. That's very nice. And this means I have, if I want to do eigenvectors and I want to do principal component analysis, we'll need to do some mathematics. And the mathematics is called a covariance matrix. That means you calculate the expectancy of how much is it changing from the mean. So how much is the variation in the different directions? But you have to subtract the mean. Well, subtraction of the mean is exactly that surrounding around some pixel, that's the mean. It's negative, you subtract it. So we have now a much better idea what your retina is actually doing. Your retina is putting all your data to the center. So that center surround subtracts the background from it, and you put the data to the center. And I did some very experiments, and they got famous actually, on PCA, on small images. So you have an image here, and I said, suppose I'm a baby that begins to learn, and I have all these, suppose I'm a monkey, and I show these, what does a monkey see? It sees leaves. And I decided to put very tiny patches on this image. And these patches are very small, 12 by 12 pixels. But I have quite a few of them. So what do? I put all these 12 by 12 pixels in one column vector. And from every little square I have a column vector. And together I form a big matrix. All these columns next to each other. And I do this analysis, this mathematical technique. Marius, this may be nice for you. If I have all these patches, I do PCA on these patches. And when I get the PCA on all these random patches, I exactly find all my Gaussian derivatives.
So these are the principal components.
These are the principal components.
Principal components, yeah.
So I find the first derivative in X and in Y, I find the second derivative. And you can do many calculations on these. These are steerable, these are multi-scale. But these are learned. These are learned from the data, because I have a lot of different orientations here, I find all these orientations. But now, and that made me a little bit...
So they can function as a basis. for an image.
No function, they are a basis. Yeah. And what they actually do, they do the Taylor expansion. So the Taylor expansion means that I stand in a point and I want to find how is the neighborhood of my point look like. I need all my derivatives. And that's exactly what is done. That is inner structure, that is tension. So we went into Lie group theory and we could very nicely do all the mathematics of this Lie group. This is the Lie group of translation and the infinitesimal generator are all these differential operators. That's the real mathematics of this. So it's beautiful. But now comes the point. Suppose you learn a restricted image. You are an animal and you live in a forest and you have only vertical trees. That means there are no, if I see the difference between pixels up and down, it's always zeros. There are only differences in horizontal. So the y derivatives in the vertical directions are always zero. And if you learn the principal components from this image, you get the first derivative in x, the first derivative in y. You only get derivatives in the horizontal direction, so the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the seventh. And only here you get the first y derivative, with some y derivative structure. So you get completely different filters if you learn completely different structure. So this means, if I have only vertical structure, I only learn vertical data. And this is very nice, because now we don't have handcrafted filters anymore, but the filters are in the data, you learn them, and that's the basic, the core of deep learning. Your data gives you the filters. And now I show you a very famous experiment of a cat. This is a cat that was kept in the dark, and this cat could be, it was put in a cage, and this cage had only horizontal lines. So this cat was here 3 days a day, or 3 hours a day, and the rest of the day it was in complete darkness. This was done after birth, if it opens its eyes, it was a young kitten. So it only learned horizontal stripes. So this cat, cruel experiment of course, they put this cat and they showed it the horizontal line and it can see the horizontal line because it had learned horizontal lines. But now they show the cat a vertical line and it has completely no receptive fields, no filters for vertical lines. It fell asleep. Because this cat had never developed vertical line detectors. So that's pretty amazing. It depends on what you see. If you have a kid and you blind one eye because you think something is wrong, and the first 3 months you blind your eye, it will never see stereo anymore. Because the first 3 months you build your neural network. So it's quite serious. You have to have a very rich environment and then you build a rich set of filters. So this lesson is you learn the filters that you see. And of course, later the cat went back to its family and it started to learn all the things again. But you have the same thing. Marius, how many faces do you see?
In this image. For example, I could see that face with the stones. There are many I could see.
But how would you hallucinate?
You never know. So we have the tendency to see faces everywhere.
Well, this is not hallucination. I really see a face here, and I really see a face here.
I don't know whose face is that, but yeah.
No, of course not. Yeah, there is don't know these stones, but this looks like a face.
Another face on the left, right there.
So this is actually the task of a doctor. He has to find tumors in the same way, and it takes the doctor quite a long time to find all these things. So this is computer-aided diagnosis. We help the doctor, and I say, with my deep learning or whatever, hey doctor, look here, this is detection. And now the doctor is very happy because this face I didn't see. But now my computer says, doctor, look here, there may be something suspect, something to see. He's very happy because now he does better healthcare. But now comes the trick. This is exactly the same image.
And you don't see any face.
Why not?
Because of this, we are not rotation invariant in the way we see.
No, you are rotation, but you have never learned phases upside down.
Yeah.
That's the good answer. So this is not an invariance, it is what have you learned? A phase upside down doesn't exist.
So,
you don't see
what I meant is that I'm not doing a mental rotation perfectly to align. Because if I did a mental rotation quickly, I could, but I don't do it.
So there is some matter rotation.
You could do it, but it's very difficult now to see the faces. Even if I help you and I say, okay, here are the faces, it's difficult to see. And we are extremely face machines. It is amazing. There's a Google website. If you type in Google faces everywhere, this is faces everywhere, and I look at images. You see these images? It's of course not a face, but everybody thinks, hey, this looks like two eyes and a nose. And they're everywhere. This coffee, yeah, it looks a little bit like a face. What's that nothing to do with a face? But we are so triggered for faces that we see faces everywhere. And that's because of this pattern that is so burned into our... We have so much learned that. Not faces upside down, not faces in a way, but this is a very nice way. And the basic way is to do this principal component analysis. You get the basis filters. And we have now found the beautiful mathematics of this self-organization. So you look actually at patches. And I have a patent with one of my students. Of course, if you have these tensors and you need to go to the next level, it becomes quite complicated in legal theory, but we found the nice grouping method in the next level. So we could now combine these contextual edges into noses and so on. And that's a crucial step.
So are you doing the same principal component at every level in the neural net so that you can pre-train it in an unsupervised manner?
This is much more complicated. This goes into legal theory where we include much more, you include rotations, you include all kinds of many more complex things. So we have a higher contextual thing. This is actually the mathematics of Gestalt. I can go much deeper, but for this course it goes too deep. But we have found, and this is...
Is it published or just...
It is being reviewed, it's now being... But people, I get very excited to comment about it. And we already found that we have now 100 times faster training because we don't need to train the data, we can go directly to these data. We have the filters now directly, so this is a very crucial step. I'm very proud of it. I patented this, but by the way.
So we can find the patent online?
I own this. It is being, not yet, it is okay. In the process. Okay. So, we have all these Gaussian derivative filters. If you look at, for example, these neural nets, and you're downloading from, you look at this repository, if you look at this big neural net, Inception V1, trained on these 1.2 million images, what you can do in Mathematica, and I think they do this further on, visualize convolutional weights. You can do net extracts. You just pull out one layer of this trained network with a single command. And you look at how do the filters look like, and you see they beautifully look like, it's pretty noisy, but these Gaussian derivatives. And I wrote a whole book about this, and one of the chapters goes about color receptor fields, and you very nicely find the red, green, and blue, yellow color derivatives. It directly comes from PCA, from color patches. So this is a very nice, again, mathematical theory on understanding the first layer. So now you go a little bit deeper in deep learning, not only apply it, but also get some feeling of, hey, that's what these filters do. They take derivatives. Edges detection is a little bit too simple, that's only the first derivative. But it takes many more. So this is...
So maybe we are trying to approximate, to give a Taylor series approximation of the world with this higher level of derivatives and...
But that's only layer one, and of course we have all the layers.
Yes, so, but we can go... Now we can do it again.
Yeah.
The next level.
So this is the Taylor expansion, it's mathematics, and this means you stand at the point A, and how is the world looking a little bit next to me? You need the derivative, the second derivative, the third derivative, and this is exactly what we measure with our eye. It's really cute, quite nice. I go talk a little bit what has been discovered more in the visual system to understand a little bit better. If you have a line like this, a kid can already connect all these lines. Computers cannot. It's it's difficult. You have to see, well, if I have a line, where is the next line coming? So it turns out that our brain is very well equipped to do just this. So if you look carefully at the brain, how does it look like? You have a retina here, and there's something amazing. The right half of your retina goes to the right half of your brain, and the other half of the retina goes to the other part of your brain. So there's a vertical line in your first visual field. That part goes to here, and the other part goes to there. It's very strange. So you have not one place, but it is just split. Nobody knows why this is. There are some ideas that people say, well, suppose this was a very tiny animal and it had only one eye. If there was food here to the right, okay, you have food to the right, then the light comes on this part of the retina. Okay, you have a leg here or a pedal. Use this pedal and you go to the food. If the food is on the other side, the light falls here, you use this pedal. But I don't know, that may be it. Anyway, people have studied in great detail all the shapes of all these cells and how do they connect and how do they look like. And what happens? If you see what we do in deep learning we have this filter and we project to the next layer. And in this case we make 48 different filters. Well, the visual system is doing exactly the same. So the visual system is making a whole stack of measurements in one pixel. And that stack is on the cortex of your brain, and we have all vertical cells here, and all these different levels in the cell are different measurements here. We call this a cortical column. So this is actually a feature vector in the brain. We have exactly the same as in the deep learning. And we can measure now in the brain what these guys do. We can stick a needle in there, we can measure, we have all these optical measurements. So that's beautiful. So we really come to a point that, wow, it's... And this happens if you show a mouse lines with different orientation. This is what the cortex is doing. It's crazy. It's ridiculous. It doesn't even look like lines.
So that is an image from your... So
this is a voltage-sensitive dyes. So the pasta you put on the brain, I explained it in the previous hour, it gives a fluorescent effect if you have an action potential. So you see here an amazing pattern, and how can you make any theory?
Yeah, but there is a correlation, a strong correlation between them.
Well, people zoomed in, and what happened? If you look carefully, it turns out that this rotation is in very tiny islands. It's called a hypercolumn, and these hypercolumns are world famous now. And every laboratory is studying these hypercolumns. And you have thousands of these hypercolumns on your brain. And why in the world do we have these very strange stuff? It looks like a small circle, and it is orientation. So people look carefully, and if you look in what happens in one of such hypercolumns, all the cells here, and this is about 100,000 by 100,000 cells, so there's a lot of cells here. They're beautifully organized
into orientation.
So all the cells along one spoke, this is called a pinwheel, they all have the same orientation. And the big ones are here and the small ones are there. So we have multi-scale, multi-orientation. And this is the full computer for one pixel. This is a multi-orientation computer for one pixel. Mm-hmm. That's pretty amazing. So for every pixel we do an amazing amount of calculations at all orientations. Why at all orientations? Because we have not a single x and y axis, so we have to do that at all orientations. And now it's quite nice that we could do the same in mathematics. So we rotated all these filters, we calculated all the different filters, and then you get x, y, and here's the orientation, you get something mathematically much more complex. But now, because we have this what's called orientation score, in a single point you can represent multiple orientations. So we have here all these orientations. But if you have a crossing like here, it was always difficult to do image processing here. You didn't know what to do, what happens here. But now we have split it up in different levels. And for the first time, we could now, even where there were many crossings and were noisy, we could completely have the filters here in all the different orientations. And this was a cum laude of my PhD students. And many microscopy companies use this now, because it was for the first time that you could do very nice denoising, even if it was very much crossing. Because we just looked how does the brain do it, and the brain is pulling out all these orientations, and we did the same. So this guy got a cum laude, and he's now working at this Traian microscopy company, and it is widely used now. But it was quite a spectacular progress. But we went even further. People did nice experiments, and we have all these multi-orientation and orientation is now in color. So you see here, this is the central point of these pinwheels, all the different colors. Here's another one, here's another one. They injected some ink here, and you see the color coding. Blue means cells that are sensitive for vertical lines. So they injected some ink in a blue area, and they waited for a week, and the ink was spreading out slowly, and we looked at where did it go. So where are the connections in the brain? And they found after a week that it was spreading to other blue areas in an elliptical region. So that means blue areas were talking to each other. The blue is a vertical detector, so if I have a vertical detector, I'm standing here, my neighbor is connected to me, he's telling me, hey Bart, I'm also vertical. And this guy tells me, I'm also vertical. So all my neighbors tell me, we are vertical, and we're in the same line, so we must be on the same contour. And I'm pretty sure that I'm vertical, because all my neighbors are saying that I'm also vertical, so we must be on the same contour. Well, this is context processing. This is gestalt. But we now have the beautiful mathematics of this, because we have this multi-orientation domain. So it works really nice. So the red guys, horizontal, talk to each other like this. The vertical guys talk to each other like that. And we see this in the brain. So we learned from this, and we said, okay, let's implement this. So we did a lot of mathematics on this, and we could then find all these lines. And with this theory, we now have a beautiful way of what's called perceptual grouping, line continuation. So now, even if a line is broken, we can now fully connect it. And we have all these very tiny blood vessels in the retina. It was noisy, sometimes it was not really complete. But with this technique, we could now perfectly find the lines like we humans do. So it's very learning from the brain how to do it. So here you see what happens. We have these very noisy, tacky images from the retina, but we could nicely clean them up. And this is the latest stuff that we have now. People are discovering that we have not pixels at all in our retina, but we have these big receptive fields. We have 23 different tilings of receptive fields. So we have 23 low resolution detectors that look at the world. It has nothing to do with pixels. So your brain is probably much more clever. If you see a pixel, it measures the overlap of 23 coarse things. And that seems to be very clever, more clever than measuring that single pixel, then you need a million things. So this is now the state of the art. If you read the current papers on what they're doing, and they measure local velocities, they measure local histogram of gradients, they measure the intensity, so it is far more complex than just a pixelized detector.
So are there 23 one on top of the other, like layers?
No, they're all intermixed, so they...
Or they're like super pixels?
Yeah.
Superimposed.
Super pixels, yeah, they're superimposed. So the different rods and cones participate in different things. So we call that...
The same resolution? Sorry, all of them the same resolution?
No, they come in different and smaller resolutions, and much is not yet known. This is full in progress now. This is a revolution. People are now looking far more into this from, wow, hey, what happens? So there are far more studies on...
And this is only the fovea or the whole
This is for the whole retina. The fovea is special because there the rods and cones are very, very tiny. That's where you look really sharp. But this is for the whole retina.
So they go to the brain to different channels, different nerves?
They go to the brain to different channels. So we have actually a lot of different channels going to the brain. There are separate velocity channels, separate color channels, separate histogram gradient channels. So it is far more complicated than just a camera with pixels. And I think it's extremely clever. It does subtraction. You don't need high resolution. You can do with way less energy and firing to do the same. So I think we should study this far more.
And this is duplicated in the lateral genicular nucleus?
Yes. Yes, exactly the same. It just goes on there. So if you, for example, have a look at how do we see color, it's remarkable that if you study the cortex and you see all these, here are these pinwheels. This is the left eye and this is the right eye, so we have hope this is one pinwheel, another one. And color is only in very small blobs. And people say, why is this? Why have we only 10% of the cells is for color? And then I realized that there is there was a very famous paper from a guy in Israel, and he said it's called, the guy was called Levin, polarization. If you have an image like this, do we really need all these different color pixels? But actually, if we can do segmentation, and we know that deep learning can do very nice segmentation. If I have a black and white image, and I only give some indications of the color, and my deep learning knows the segment, it turns out that if you color all these images with these very little stripes, you get this image. So we really don't need all the color pixels. So it's pretty stupid to make a triple from every pixel. So if you have a megapixel, 1000 by 1000, and every pixel is RGB, you have 3 megapixel data. Well, the brain says it's not necessary at all. If you have a few pixels for that segment, I color them all in. And that's efficient. So we should think about everything in a different way. So, colorization. I showed Elena the black and white image, you remember, that it was fully pictured, and we colored your lips red and so on. It's done this way. It's extremely effective.
What would be the spatial resolution of these color sensitives?
The same. There's not a single change in spatial resolution. This image has exactly the same resolution.
No, I mean, if you just looked at the color sensitive cells, what would be the spatial resolution associated to this?
It's about 1/10, so there's far less. And you see also that the area of these are cytooxidase blobs, as they're called. So there's a very limited representation of color only necessary. So that's actually quite nice. Another method that we think, hey, the brain is really different working. So there's a lot coming in deep learning that we don't know yet. And here's the one I showed you before. That's all these. We can do segmentation really fast. And this coloring can now be done by this colorization method. Histogram of gradients, we saw
Can you tell us how the segmentation is done?
Sorry?
Can you tell us how the segmentation is done?
Yes. You just have to read this paper, and it tells exactly how they do it. It's a pretty famous paper. It's really nice. It's a group in Hong Kong, and they very nicely show the results and the movies.
Well, there are many papers on semantic segmentation. You can use U-nets, you can use skip connections, dilated convolutions. There are tons of papers.
If you type semantic segmentation,
if you want, so.
If you this is from YouTube. If you type semantic segmentation, you got lots of examples. This is quite a famous one, but as I said, there are quite a few. Let's look at what the brain is doing with this histogram of gradients, and people have found in the retina remarkable cells and they are just after the rods and the cones. They found cells like this, and they have a star shape. That's why they're called stellate, and they're called emigrant cells. So, and they have at the end pretty nice detectors, and these are gradient detectors. So it's pretty amazing that they are in your eye, and you have an amazing number of these cells. They overlap with at least a factor of 70 to sometimes 100. So people do very nice measurements to have nanoscale measurements. You know what they did in this case? This was from a mouse. They took a square millimeter from the mouse and they put that in the microscope. But the microscope was quite special. They wanted to have nanometer resolution. So there was an electron microscope. And they wanted to have 3D. So with a laser, they could kick off the first nanometer. So they had a kind of a laser knife. Then they took the next image. They cut off the next nanometer and they took the next image. So they had an image that was 150,000 by 150,000 by 50,000. That's a huge image. And in this image, they had to find all these very tiny synapse details. And they said, let's do this by hand, because this cannot be done by computer. So they had 50,000 images, huge. And they said, we cannot do this ourselves, so we published this, and they asked people, can you join us? And they found 1,000 people that joined them. So everyone took a couple of pictures, and they drew by hand. And then finally, they had by hand all the connections of this cell. It was a Nature paper. That was really super. Only 1,000 volunteers who did this. If you read this, it was a paper by Brigham. It's fantastic. And they also did some calcium studies that they found that the gradient here was only sensitive in the direction to the center. So this here was in the direction of the yellow arrow. In the bottom, they found gradients that were sensitive in the direction to the center here, so they were in the green arrow. So functional imaging and anatomical imaging can now be integrated. And we do this now cell for cell, what happens here, what do these cells. And you have 26 different emigrant cells. And we only know from 5 of them what they do. So all the other ones are still to be discovered. And probably there's far more fancy processing there. And I find it fascinating. The next 10 years of my life, I go really into this and try to find out, hey, what can we learn from deep learning and what can we do with this? It's fascinating. I hope to write a lot about this particular stuff. So I think, but I'm not sure, but that will be, has to be proven next year, that this stellate emigrant cell maybe is the gravity gradient detector. In both worlds, they're very effective. So it could very well be. Last thing is that we have the fovea, was the first question. But why in the world do we have a fovea? None of our cameras has a fovea. My smartphone doesn't have a fovea.
It's very nice.
So why not?
I like this example.
Well, you see sharply at this point, but you only see one point. Because outside of the fovea, you cannot see sharp. But if you look here, you see this point sharp. And if you look here, you only see sharp when you look. Yeah?
So you're blind to the others because
yeah, you have a very coarse. So we don't need sharp sampling everywhere. So, Maris, it even goes further. What actually happens is I looked at another major area that is 3D SLAM. You know 3D SLAM? Mm-hmm. It's. Let me show you the movie. This is a guy in Berkeley.
That's a completely different area, actually.
It is, but that's why it's so nice to bring. This guy has a LIDAR. And what's a LIDAR? It's a laser system that measures the distance. So he walks with this guy, with this LIDAR on his head, and he measures the world around him. And in his computer, he keeps a representation of the 3D world. And while he walks around, he creates the map of the world around him by walking around. And the LIDAR is his fovea. We also scan the world. And actually, we don't need to have the world in sharp detail. We only want to have the world in sharp detail if you look at it. If I look at your face, only then I see the details. So I don't need to have the full details measured. I can live with very coarse pixels, and only when I look at it, I fill it in sharp. And I remember it. So the brain's extremely good in remembering it. It stores this. And 3D SLAM is so good that you can do this on a smartphone. So it's very effective. So you don't need millions of pixels 50 times per second. You have a very coarse resolution. You only fill in when you need it. That's what we do. That's another energy saving.
But this contextual peripheral vision is also important for getting the general feeling, not just
of
the...
Of course, that's a deeper layer in neural networks where you have all the deeper contextual things. But I'm just saying that this processing is in the retina. And if you look at the retina, and this is how the retina looks like, this is the size, and here you have the distance from the fovea. And you see that they get bigger if you go further away. And we have two groups of cells. This cell is for shape, and these are for motion. So these are actually these receptive fields, these bigger areas. The blue or red area field, you remember from the 20 retina. And there is a linear increase with eccentricity, as we call it. And people have used it. This was used by my PhD student, Prof, the leader of this group in Nijmegen. He said, hey, we can do far better deep learning if we do the same with the retina style, that we do very nice sampling in the middle, but we do coarse sampling if we go outside. Then you can reach a larger area, but you don't need the computational expenses of all the many calculations because you have coarser pixels. And doing this with a retina-shaped filter, they were extremely efficient. They could work 10 times faster, and they had the same performance, accuracy, and sensitivity of the neural network.
So do they focus on specific key points, specific areas of
high
entropy or something?
No, that's just the convolution. The convolution shifts over the image, and the fovea goes all over. But the sampling outside of the filter is done in a coarse way, so that's really effective. So there are many ways that we can learn from the brain in terms of these things. I give you just a sample of what's currently thinking, and this is the geometric way of thinking that's a little bit different, and I really like it. So I conclude this section, and then we go to... Yeah, it's fine. I will talk much more about applications. Well, we have a lot of energy saving, conjectures I call them, because it's not yet sure. We have the subtraction, that you only need a few percent of the pixels, because most of the pixels remain the same, and I think vision is doing that, and we should do this much more in our visual processing, video processing as well. We have the center surround, which is doing batch normalization. It puts all the data around the mean, so you get natural coordinate systems from the data. You have these cortical columns. They are the representation of the tensors that we see in the deep learning. We have all these multi-orientation hypercolumns, these pinwheels. They talk to each other. And that's exactly what they do. They tell each other, hey, you're a line, I'm a line, we are connected. We have a kind of a voting system. So we can now deal with all kinds of interrupted lines. We know that color processing, you really don't need it for every pixel. If you just color code a few pixels and you segment the whole area, segmentation can be done really well. We find it. And we have the fovea. And the fovea is very clever. It only makes sharp where you look at. And the rest, you need it very, very, very rough. So these are a couple of ideas that I want to take you home refreshing ideas in deep learning. This is completely different from the normal thinking, but it gives you some idea on in which way should we try to go explain what happens. What's the black box doing? We don't know. We need another 10 years. We need you to dive into this. Of course, you start with using a neural network, download it, and apply it. But those who want to go a little bit deeper understanding it, please contact me. Okay, I showed this before. We have a lot of revolutions going on, and biomedical is very well equipped for this time. So I go stop here. We take a little break, and then I go very nicely showing applications of all of this in taking pictures from the red set. That will be my last half hour, and then we go do some practice. Okay, thanks. Let's take a pause.